All around us, there are troubles, and there are trials round every turn. And though that cold wind won't stop blowing, there's a fire in my bones. And it keeps me going, keeps me going, keeps me going on. The joy of the Lord is my strength and my song, that sweet melody in my soul all day long. No matter what comes, I just keep going on, 'cause the joy of the Lord is my strength and my song. Till the trumpet sounds and the bells are ringing, till he calls me home, no, I won't stop singing. For every question, there's an answer. For every problem, there's a prayer. But greater is he that lives within me than all the trouble here in this world. The joy of the Lord is my strength and my song, that sweet melody in my soul all day long. No matter what comes, I just keep going on, 'cause the joy of the sounds and the bells are ringing till he calls me home. No, I won't stop singing. I've got that joy down in my soul. I've got that joy, joy of the Lord. I've got that joy down in my soul. I've got that joy, joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is my strength and my song. Sounds and the bells are ringing till he calls me home. No, I won't stop singing. The trumpet sounds and the bells are ringing till he calls me home. No, I won't stop singing.
We sure do love y'all. And, you know, tonight, it'd be really important for you if you can just go shh to your crazy heart and allow it to be still and awesome before the Lord, right? Just be in God's presence. Don't let the world around you dictate your life. It's just about you and Him right now, right? It's cool. Let's worship the Lord, okay? Lord, we love you and we thank you for this church. We thank you for what you do in and through these guys. We thank you so much, Lord, for how you've ministered to me and my family through these guys. We thank you for what they do on a day-to-day basis and what they do in this city. And Lord, we're just grateful to be a part of your work here. So just come and have your praise, the praise of your people, as we lift your name higher than any name. In Jesus' name we say, amen. As I was buried beneath my shame, who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. And I was breathing but not alive, and all my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. All right, let's hear it, church. It's when you call my name, sing it! Out of the darkness into your glorious day. Yeah, you call my name. I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. Now your mercy. Cause now your mercy has saved my soul, and your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, Jesus, when I met you. Cause when you call my name, sing it! Out of the darkness into your glorious day. Here you call my name. I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. Are you ready? Are you singing? Come on.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan, but now you're calling me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. Cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. Here you call my name. I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. Here you call my name. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. 'Cause in the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I rise, hey, in the morning, when I rise, well, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all of this world, but give me Jesus. Is when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, when I am alone, well, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. When I come to die, oh, when I come to die, when I come to die, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. Of this world, you can have all of this world. Who you can have all of this world? Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus, you can have all of this world. You can have all of this world.
Just give me Jesus, amen? Give me Jesus. You may be seated. Hey, as always, on Wednesday nights, Sundays, we'd like to welcome anybody that's joining us for the first time. If you could just raise your hand, any first-time visitors with us today? Anybody with us for the first time? First-timers, first-timers, first-timers? No? Welcome back, Arkies. Welcome back. If you are joining us online for the first time, we welcome you to our Wednesday night service. As you guys know, we just had our Passion Week, our annual Passion Week, where we had 12 services throughout the week. It was an awesome, awesome week of just Bible study and worship and food. And there were so many of you guys that helped participate in that and helped serve and cooked food and were here ushering and parking and all that good stuff. And so we just want to thank you guys for your service last week. There were so many people that came out, and it was just a wonderful time of worship and just celebrating the resurrection of our Lord. So we thank you guys so much for all that you guys did. This Sunday, we made some adjustments with our Rise and Shine services that were supposed to start in May. We actually expedited, and they're going to be starting this Sunday, our Rise and Shine, at 7:30 in the morning. So if you were hoping to jump in on this, it starts this Sunday. We're going to be in Building 3. We'll have worship and then the same study with Bancho to start our Sunday morning. So that's happening this Sunday. Also happening this Friday is the Marriage Home Studies. They are doing classes on Fridays and also on Saturday classes at 9:30. They have homes in Pico Rivera, Montebello, Norwalk, Cerritos, and again, they all begin this Friday. They're going to be going through the book called Bible Study for Couples by Dennis and Barbara Rainey. So if you haven't signed up, make sure to get signed up. They're at the table outside, and you can get connected with that, and the cost is $20 for that. So that's the Marriage Home Studies. Friday also, all our ministries are back in action. Quench, Connect Ministry, which is ages 26 to 35. The Rooted, which is 18 to 25-year-olds. Spanish Ministry, we're going to be back as far as a full schedule this Friday. So make plans to join us for any of those. We also have our junior high boys who are having the Nerfing event Friday. We have a couple signups still available there. If you want to sign up your son, you can go to the high school ministry and sign them up tonight for that Friday event. And then starting next Friday, April 12th, we're kicking off the Thank God It's Friday with a bonfire, burgers, bash. Just we're going to party it up back there. So bring your kids, 6th through 12th grade. You don't need to sign up. Just bring them on out and be ready to pick them up because you can't leave them here, all right? So be ready to pick them up that night. But it's going to be fun, so keep us in prayer with that. Fresh Start begins their next session Monday, April 15th at 7 p.m. This is a weight loss support group that helps women just live a healthy lifestyle, both physically and spiritually. So you can sign up and make plans to join for that. So yeah, that's what we got. Food court, the worship ministry, kids worship ministry, youth worship ministry, they're over there and they are doing tostadas. They're doing nachos. You can go over there and support the ministry there. And so with that, let's all stand. We'll pray for our offering. Again, as always, Jeff has a table out there. You can go over there, pick up some music and get connected. But also we want to pray for a couple of different Arkies. We got Felicia Castro. She's the daughter of one of our Arkies. She is still in ICU after choking, and we're going to lift her up today and ask the Lord to have mercy on her. Also, Vicky Espinosa is in battling cancer and critical care, so we want to lift them two up tonight and ask the Lord to be with them. Father, we lift up both Vicky, Lord, and Felicia, Father, both in critical care, both in a moment in their life, Lord, where they need your intervention, Father, upon their bodies, Lord. And so we pray for a miracle, Lord, on both of them, that you would heal them, that you would just be merciful to them, Lord God, and that you would just pour out your spirit upon their family, Lord, as their family goes through this time of suffering with them, Lord Jesus. And so may you just do a work in their lives, Lord, and just remind them, Father, remind them of the tender love that you have towards them as they go through what they're going through, Lord. And for us here, Lord, we just want Jesus, Lord. As that last song said, we just want to see Jesus. And so we pray that you would meet us here right where we're at, Lord. We pray over the offering that you would bless it and that you would continue to use it for your good and perfect will, Lord. And we just love you, Father. We love you so much, and we thank you for this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
It's always better when babies do it.
Thank you.
Amen.
Wow. Wow, wow, wow. That was, oh, that was so precious. That was so beautiful. Some of you are teary-eyed. I know that. I saw a lady there wiping her tears. I was holding my back, but I couldn't. That's beautiful. Oh, God, you are faithful. You're such a good, loving, and gracious God. To you now and always, let it be honor and glory and power and might and dominion. We love you, Lord. We thank you and praise you. Before you, Father, we bow our hearts down. Forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us, Lord, from all unrighteousness. Let it all be about you, Lord. Let it all be about you, about your glory and your majesty. Let us worship you. Father, even as we read the scriptures, Lord, let us worship you, for you're a God worthy of glory and honor. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. Go before us, Father. Go before us. Speak to us through the scriptures. May the Holy Spirit manifest himself mightily as he touches our hearts when we open the word. You'll open up our eyes and give us wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, Father. Let it all be now and always for your glory, Lord. We thank you once again for your goodness. We lift up our pastor, Pancho. Father, may you bless him. Father, may you continue to strengthen him and bring healing to his, not just, Father, to his mind, but to his neck as it's been hurting for so long. Father, we pray for a miracle of healing. May you bless his family and bless all of our congregation, Lord. Father, we pray for Anthony's mommy, as Father, she's not feeling well. Carolina and Anthony used to be a parking attendant and taking care of us. And now, Father, we lift him up together with his mom. We pray for blessings upon him. Father, I pray for all of the people that the congregation right now have in their own hearts. We lift up our own needs. I care for my family. Many of them are hurting. I know the congregation is praying for their own family members. Father, we lift them up into your hands. May you receive all the glory and honor when you do these wonderful, mighty miracles. We thank you once again, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Wow, that was beautiful worship. You can say hello to one another if you like at this time, and then you're more than welcome to get comfy in your seats. Tonight, we are going to be studying through the Gospel of John. I think it's very fitting. We just celebrated Resurrection Sunday, right? And it was a very beautiful event. At least it was to me, and I hope it was a blessing to you as well. And interestingly enough, we just finished chapter 19. We spoke about Jesus Christ's death, and we're going to look into his resurrection right now. But before we go to John chapter 20, I want you, if you're so kind, please go with me to first book of John. After 1st and 2nd Peter, we find the first book of John. And in chapter 3, we're going to read a few verses, starting with verse 1. Chapter 3 of the first book of John. Are you all there? Okay, wonderful. This is what it says. It says, "Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us, because they did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we should be. But we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." And here in verse 3 it says, "And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure." Is that your hope, to see him as he is? Well, then the calling of the Holy Spirit for all of us is that we must seek to live a pure life. Why? Because he is pure. He has said prior through the scriptures, "Be thou holy, for I am holy." We worship a holy God, yes or no? Therefore, we pray and ask the Lord to help us to live a holy living. Now, let us go to chapter 20 of the Gospel of John. The way this chapter, at least in our New King James Version, is subdivided, basically is broken down in five parts. And I really like that division within itself. So I'm not going to touch it. I'm actually going to go through those various divisions, and we're going to touch in certain points, and we're going to look for certain meanings and see how that can be applied to our own lives. Are you already there in the Gospel of John, chapter 20? Yes? Wonderful. Let us now begin by reading verses 1 to verse 10. Now, the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early, while it was still dark. She saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and she came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter, therefore, went out and the other disciple, and they were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he stooped down, and looking in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him. He went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not laying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who came to the tomb first, went in also, and he saw and believed. For as they did not know the scriptures that he must arise again from the dead, then the disciples went away again to their own homes. When we just read this section, if we're not familiar with other gospels, that's why it's so important to read everything in the Bible, all the way from Genesis to Revelation. It is all inspired. If you have been consistently reading through the scriptures, maybe 5 to 4 chapters every day, by the time the year is over, you would have pretty much read the whole Bible through. As a matter of fact, for sure, you would have read the whole Bible through. But when you get to read the Gospels, you have to understand the Gospels are 4 accounts of the life of Jesus Christ, his ministry, his miracles, death, and resurrection. But they all come from a perspective of 4 different men. Some of them are eyewitnesses themselves, as Matthew and John. Mark and Luke aren't. But they receive the account and they put it all together. So there's going to be certain elements that may be missing in one account that are found in other accounts. So when you read them all, you're going to have, I would say, a 4-dimensional perspective of who is Jesus Christ's work and ministry. In Mark chapter 16, I'm not asking you to go there. It's just because, for lack of time, I'm going to take you to other verses later on. But in Mark chapter 16, verse 9, he describes Mary Magdalene as a woman who Jesus Christ had cast out of her 7 demons. So throughout, unfortunately, history and tradition, many people have been claiming that Mary Magdalene is a prostitute. But the Bible doesn't speak like that about her. So if at any point in time you thought, well, Mary Magdalene, she was prostitute or any other word you want to call her, that is not the case, at least not when it comes to the scriptures. But she is described as a woman who at one point in time had 7 demons in her. So when you see people out there in the street and you might say, man, that person is demon-possessed, that person may actually well be demon-possessed. It's a possibility. But Christ can heal. So no matter who is out there that you may think that person is too far away that Christ cannot bring them salvation and healing and a right mind and restore a relationship, then we're actually minimizing the power of God. When you look at the problem looks too big. Look at Christ and every problem will look smaller. Amen? To this woman, she has so much love for Jesus Christ. She's the very first one to be there early in the morning, even before the sun is out, she's there by the tomb. In Mark chapter 16, verse 1, it also tells us that a lady named Salome had been there together with her. So when you think it was only Mary Magdalene, no, there were other people there. Luke chapter 24, verses 10, tells us that Mary, the mother of James, was there, that Joanna was there as well, and also other women was there with them, or were there with them, without giving us the name. So how many women were there? We don't know. And the Lord is not trying to explain that to us. What he does show us is that those who love Jesus, and at one point in time were so fearful of what could happen to them because of Jesus Christ's arrest, at this point in time, love brings them to that place where they're willing to chance it. They're willing to risk their lives, going to prison, being tortured, suffering consequences. And that's a lesson that is very important for all of us. Because if we love Jesus Christ, then we have to understand that our life, it has to be an example of the life of Christ. Why were owls with Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit call us his ambassadors? An ambassador is someone who represents either a king or a president or a kingdom, but he is a representative. So if all of a sudden you see an ambassador, you know, with his shirt all the, you know, open all the way and his hairs are sticking out, you know, probably walking with a, I don't know, some sort of a groove, you might think, hey, that's the way their president probably walks around their country, because he represents the president. Yes or no? We are called to be ambassadors. And here, in this case, you see this lady will become one of the first ambassadors to the very same apostles and disciples that Jesus Christ had been instructed for 3 years. They're going to take the message to them, and the amazing thing is that they are not going to believe. That is spoken in Luke chapter 24, verse 11. I want you to go there with me, because that will, between Luke and this passage in John in chapter 20, I think we can actually make very good sense of what has taken place. Let's go to Luke chapter 24, Luke chapter 24, and I'm going to read verses 8 to 12, okay? Luke chapter 24, verses 8 to 12. I would suggest, if you can, please mark Luke chapter 24. So when we go back, it become a lot easier for you to maneuver through the scriptures. Starting with verse 8, it says, "And they remember his words." Oh, what words were they remembering? You know what? I'm going to have to read from a few verses before. That's going to be verse 6. "He's not here." These are the angels that are speaking to them. "He's not here. He has risen. Now remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise again.'" I want you to have that right now in your memory, because later on we're going to hit up on it. We don't have to go back. "Now, and they remember his words, and then they returned from the tomb, and they told all of these things to the 11 and to all of the rest." Pause right there. Who are the rest? Well, the 11 are what we call the apostles. The rest are disciples. And they're all meeting in one place. And that is a very important example for all of us. Somebody mentioned to me that they enjoy when I said that you cannot actually fully participate and enjoy the service when you are at home watching it via the internet. That is true. That is true. You may receive the information from the scriptures, but we are here not just to hear what the scripture have to say. We are here to worship together. We're here to pray for one another. We're here to encourage one another. We're here to utilize the gifts that God has given us, that we may become a blessing for one another, also to glorification of God. He calls us to be together. Here, they were together. Now, it says here in verse 10, "It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and other women with them who told these things to whom? To the apostles. And their words seemed to them like idle tales. They did not believe them. But Peter arose and he ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves, and he departed marveling to himself, at what had happened." Did you notice, right, that these ladies brought the report, and they were so excited because they understood perfectly well that Jesus had risen from the dead, correct? No, you should have said, "No, John Paul, that's not the case." They did not believe. Later on, we're going to see Thomas in this account towards the end of the chapter. And what do people call Thomas? Why don't they call all the apostles doubting apostles? Here it says that they didn't believe. You see how you can suddenly have a bad report for one person when everybody does the same thing? We're very fast at throwing stones at people, but we don't want anybody to talk trash about us. I think that's a good thing for us to understand. If you don't want people to say anything about you, you better stop talking about others. They still might talk about you, but at least you know you're not inciting it, right? We move on here Because I want you to see what happens when, in verse 8, it says that the other disciple, speaking about John, he came to the tomb first, but he didn't go in, of course. Then he saw the linen cloths, and he believed. The linen cloths, I believe, they also became a testimony to this man. He has seen Lazarus have been risen from the dead, yes or no? Not too long ago, remember, we went through that study. When Jesus Christ said, Lazarus, come forth, Lazarus came out of the tomb. He had been dead for how many days? 4 days. What did his sister say about his body? Stinketh. But when he came out, Jesus says, now loose him, and they take the wraps around. They have to take the wraps around him. Why? He probably looks like a mummy. Well, that is the way that they would, by their customs, put the body in the grave. They did the same thing for Jesus. They wrapped him up with linen cloth, and they actually interjected between the linen myrrh and spices and oils, all these things that would keep the odor of the body decomposing away, at least to preserve it as much as they could. So when John looks in, what does he see? He sees these linen cloths there on the side, folded, also the cloth that covered his face, on, you know, separate. He sees that, and I am almost certain that he sees that, and he says, that is impossible to have been done if the body had been stolen. There's no way you can actually put these linen cloths in order. He rose from the dead. Maybe somehow it dawned on him what Jesus Christ had said many times. We know that Jesus Christ, we know that for a fact in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8, chapter 9, and chapter 10. Towards the end of every one of those chapters, Jesus Christ told the disciples, I'm going to be betrayed, I'm going to be arrested, I'm going to be, you know, mistreated, killed, and 3 days afterwards, I will rise from the dead. They could not understand what he was saying. I don't think they could understand that because it was not being spiritually revealed to them. We many times read the scriptures and we cannot understand until it is revealed to us. I was talking to a gentleman who said, you know, I've been reading the Bible, but I really don't understand almost anything. Go, keep reading. If you're born again and you read the Bible for the first time, there's a good chance that you may just understand a few things. But I can guarantee if you're born again and you read the Bible a second time, you will understand more things. And if you read the Bible a third time, and your friends are going to say, when are you going to stop reading that book, dude? You already read it twice. How many times are you going to read it? You're going to have to tell your friends something that they don't understand yet. I'm going to keep reading this book until I die. Amen. Or until this book stops being relevant, which, of course, never will be, because Jesus Christ said heaven and earth will pass, but not a word will pass. Not one single word of the scripture will ever pass away. So continue to read. And here's something else that will happen if you keep on reading the scriptures. You will hear God speak to you. That is amazing. You're reading the scriptures, and you can almost hear him say your name to bring your attention to something, and then you even sometimes fall on your knees and you say, you're such a good God. Thank you. Thank you for having answered that question that I had in my heart. Thank you for giving me an answer to my life, for I did not know what to do. It says here, after he had believed, that they had not yet known the scriptures. I believe the scripture there that is mentioned is Psalm 16, verse 10. And that psalm basically says that you will not allow him to remain in the grave. Paul later on refers to that scripture saying that the anointed one that would not stay in the grave could not be David. Why? Because the tomb of David was still amongst them, meaning David died and was still in the grave. Therefore, somebody else was being spoken by the Spirit of God through David that would not remain in the tomb. Who is that? Jesus. He would not remain in the tomb. Now, after reading this section, I thought about Romans chapter 6, verses 1 to 14. We will read that, but I made myself a little notation saying, don't let your mind go home. You see, some studies have been made that our attention span has decreased through the years. You think that is true? For me, it is too. I agree with you. Yeah, my attention span is not what it used to be. So at some point in time, I had probably a 20-second attention span. Now, Lauren says I have a 10-second attention span. That might be true. But at times, you might be listening to something and it's speaking to your heart, and all of a sudden, your mind goes somewhere else, and you left the sanctuary. Your body is here, but you no longer are here. Don't let that be the case right now as we go to Romans chapter 6. We're going to read these 14 verses. We may not even stop to explain them, but I do believe that the Holy Spirit will speak to all of our hearts through what we're about to read, because it speaks about our union with Jesus Christ. We are united with Jesus Christ in our baptism. As he died, we too died with him. The Bible says that we are also crucified with him. Those are the words of the Apostle Paul. I died together with Christ. I am crucified to the world. The life that I live, I don't live it. It is Christ who lives in me. Why? Because he died lovingly for me. So let's read chapter 6 of Romans, verses 1 to 14, and I do pray that this will minister to all of us as it was ministering to me and as I was reading it, preparing the study. Here's what it says. What shall we say then? Shall we continue to sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin, for he who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we die with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead unto sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lust. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. Did Christ rise? The Bible says he rose from the dead, and we are risen together with him. The very same one, the Holy Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead, the Bible says, lives in us and shall also raise us from the grave when we die. If you're in Christ, you shall never die. But because we live forever, empowered by the Spirit, then we must live for the glory of God. Therefore, we should not surrender our bodies ever to continue to sin. Sin has no longer power over our bodies. If you are not born again, if you're watching via the internet, I should have said hello before, but if you're watching via the internet and you're not born again, you have no power to follow through with what I'm speaking about right now. There's no power in you because you don't have the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that he who does not have the Son does not have life. And the wrath of God abides in him. You have no power to say no to sin. And that's why even these words probably will resound in your ear and it'll make you feel bad. You might say, I don't want to hear that. It sounds awful. Why do these Christians have to be talking about sin? You're talking about the resurrection, which is such a beautiful day. Why don't we talk about that? Well, there is no resurrection if there is no denunciation of sin. For he came to die for sin and rose to give life. And this, I believe, is truly the power of the resurrected life, which is the title of today's study. Let's go back to chapter 20 of the Gospel of John. When he rose from the dead, we were also risen together with him. Verse 11, now it says, but Mary, she stood outside by the tomb weeping. As she wept, she stooped down and she looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other one at the feet, where the body of Jesus had laid. Then they said to the woman, or they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? And she said to them, because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know
where they have laid him. They have taken away my Lord. Those are amazing words. He already died. She doesn't know that he's risen, but she doesn't stop believing that she is that he's still Lord. And she doesn't say, the Lord. She says, my Lord. That's why she's there crying. Because it's not just like a figure that you just go and think, okay, I think nice things about him. No, she worships him. She loves him. And therefore, she says, he is my Lord. And she is broken down. And she says, I want him back. Now, verse 14, it says, now, when she has said this, she turned around and she saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. And Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and she said to him, Rabboni, which is to say teacher. And Jesus said to her, do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. And Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and that he had spoken these things to her. That brings to my memory when he says to her, Mary, what Jesus Christ has said in chapter 10, or is recorded for us in chapter 10 of the Gospel of John. He said, my sheep hear my voice, and they follow me. I believe that when he said Mary, he must have said it in a way that it brought back to her how he would speak to her. Now, I don't know all of your names, but God does. I don't know how many hairs you have in your head, except for some people here in the sanctuary, maybe. But that means you don't have any. But God knows. And like I said before, when you're reading the scriptures, you might hear him say, Jack. Now, there's no Jack in the scriptures, just so you know. But you might hear him speak to you, or saying Mary, or Martha, or Lucy, or whatever your name is. You might hear your name because he wants to speak to you. And I remember someone one day that had mentioned that the person went to the pastor and said, Pastor, there's several books that people are recommending that I should read, but I don't know if they're safe. And the pastor said, what do you mean safe? Well, books that I should not read because they can actually probably lead me away from Christ. He said, are you born again? Oh, yes, I'm born again. How did that happen? Well, I heard that Christ had died and risen again to give me life, and I believed it. So I said, Jesus, be my Lord and Savior. And when that happened, I know that I am saved because my life was transformed. I no longer am the same person. I think differently. I love the Lord. I want to be in his word. I want to go to church. I love the congregation. I mean, my life has changed, so I know that I'm saved. And he says, then if you're saved, who lives inside of you? Well, the Holy Spirit. You think the Holy Spirit will lead you astray? Oh, no, of course he won't. He's the Spirit of truth. He says, therefore, you can read anything, and God will give you discernment to what is truth. He says, just make sure you always have your Bible so you can compare it. He says, don't let people tell you what to do or not to do or what to read or not to read. Stick to the Word, and he will speak to you. And that's my advice to all of us, even to myself, is stick to the Word. You will hear him speak to you, as she could not see him at that time when she's, you know, he was standing there, but she couldn't tell who he was. Why? Because she was crying too much? I don't know. Maybe because it was like those disciples that had gone on the way to Emmaus, that he had not revealed himself in such a way that they could tell who he was. Maybe he looked different because the last time she saw him, he was so beat up right before they put him in the cross. Like Pastor Pancho was saying, he looked like hamburger meat. But now he didn't look like that. We don't follow Christ because we know what he looks like. We follow Christ because he speaks to us through the Word. And when he speaks the truth. And you know that he's spoken to you. Have you ever heard him speak to you? I've heard him. I've heard him loud and I've heard him clear. Can I describe the voice? No, I cannot. But I know what he has said. Now, from there, we can... Oh, it's beautiful here when he says, now go and... Well, don't cling to me. People make a lot of this, and I may not understand it perfectly, but I really think that what she is... She wants to have him right there. You're my Lord. Don't ever go away. And she probably throws her arms around him. And he has to say, don't cling to me. There's still work to be done. I have to ascend to the Father. Here's your job now. Go and tell my brethren. This is the first time, by the way, that he calls the disciples brethren like that. He says, go and tell my brethren. Tell them that I am going to my Father, to your Father, that I'm going to my God, to your God. And that established a beautiful relationship that we have through Jesus Christ with God, because he has made God the Father our Father. Prior to this, we had no relationship with the Father, none whatsoever. But in Christ Jesus, we are children of God. Amen? I'm going to take you to Luke chapter 24, and we're going to read a few more verses again there in Luke chapter 24. I hope you marked it. If you didn't, you're being disobedient. We're going to read from verse 36 to verse 49. Why am I going to do that? Well, because that is going to fill in some little more information that is not in the Gospel of John, but I think is very good for us to have it. So we're going to just read right through it. Luke chapter 24, verses 36 to 49. Now, as they said these things, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them, and he said to them, "Peace to you." But they were terrified and frightened, and supposed that they had seen a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do your doubt arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. But while they still did not believe for joy, and they marveled, he said to them, "Have you any food here?" And so they gave him a piece of broiled fish and some honeycomb, and he took it and he ate in their presence. I will stop there. Here's a reason why. People are going to knock on your door at some point in time, most likely on a Saturday when you're busy, and they're going to tell you, "Jesus Christ did not physically rise from the dead." This is proof that they're lying to you. He rose physically. So physically that he could actually eat fish and honeycomb. Now, I may not necessarily like the combination of fish and honeycomb. That might just be me. I'd rather have orange chicken. But that may be something that they enjoyed. Nonetheless, it just proves to them they touched him. They saw him and he ate in front of them. He physically had risen from the dead. That is a guarantee that when we rise from the dead together in the resurrection, we will have physical bodies. Don't ever think you're just going to be a ghost wandering around like a spectrum. People says, "Oh, there's a spectrum of my dad, that mom," and or other people says, "Oh, such and such died. I love them so much, but now they're watching over me." No, they're not. You have the Holy Spirit if you're born again to watch over you. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, somebody else is watching. Repent, because you need help against that somebody else. Okay, now let's move on. Verses 46 to 49, this is what it says. "And then he said to them, 'These are the words which I have spoken to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me.' And he opened their understanding that they may comprehend the scriptures. And he said to them, 'Thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. But tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endowed with power from above.'" Now, let's go to Gospel of John, verse 19. "Then, the same day at evening," remember, everything that took place is taking place through the morning, and here is in the evening of the same day, being the first day of the week, "when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst, and he said to them, 'Peace be with you.' And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them, 'Peace be to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you.' And when he has said this, he breathed on them, and he said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained.'" Unfortunately, this passage has been misunderstood by many people. He's not giving you power to forgive sins. He's actually empowering the disciples in the sense of ministry. Go and let them know that if their faith is placed on me, their sins will be forgiven, remitted, taken away, done with, gone, bye-bye, clean slate. On the other hand, if the message is given, Christ came to die for sins, was buried, rose again, showed himself alive, if you believe that, surrender to him, call him Lord, bow before his deity, he is God incarnate to reign on your life, and you said, no, I am not interested, your sins remain in you. That's exactly what he's telling them. He's not telling them, now tell someone if they say, well, I feel sorry for what I did, well, now go out there and pray this amount of times until God forgives you. You see, and here's another sad thing about that, having to do penance and prayer to receive forgiveness. Prayer should come to us naturally, like a father and a child that love each other have a conversation. I love my daddy. He passed away about 16 years ago, and I love that old man. I enjoy so much talking to him, of course, for a while, because afterwards parents start making no sense. I know that. I'm a parent, so I'm sure I get my daughter tired too. But I loved him, and I really enjoy talking to him. But if somebody who said, hey, John Paul, you misbehave, and here's going to be your punishment. You're going to have to talk to your dad. I would have said, you're a fool. I love my dad. What kind of punishment is that? Now, I don't know what relationship you have with your father. I don't know, or with your parents. You might say, you know, it is a punishment for me to talk to my parents. I hope that's not the case. But when it comes to the Father, God, it's not a punishment to talk to him. And you don't talk to him so he can forgive you. If you have put your faith and trust in Christ, you have been forgiven. Now you come to him and say, Lord, I messed up again. Would you please forgive me? And he says, yes, of course. Now come to hear my darling, my child, my beloved, and let's have a beautiful conversation. Now having said that, let's move on to verse 24. Now Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, he was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said to him, we have seen the Lord. I pause there because I believe what is interjected between these two verses is what happened to the disciples. They have had to tell them, Thomas, you should have been here, dude. You didn't go to service that day. You missed out. Tell that to your friends or your family when they don't show up. No, you should have been there. You missed out. What did I miss out? I can't tell you. You had to put your finger right there and touch. No. I believe that they told him, Thomas, he was here amongst us. We saw him. We saw the imprint of the nails. We saw them. We saw the wound on his side. And he ate with us. Thomas, it was beautiful. We wish you would have been there. And what does Thomas say to that statement from the rest of the apostles and disciples? So he said to them, unless I see his hands, or I see in his hands the print of the nails, and I put my finger into the print of the nails, and I put my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas with them, and Jesus came, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace to you. And then he said to Thomas, reach your finger here. Look at my hands. And reach your hand here and put it into my side. Do not be an unbelieving, but believe. And Thomas answered and said to him, Lord, my Lord and my God. And once again, this is something that many Jehovah's Witnesses will not want to hear. They'll say, no, he did not say, my Lord and my God. You know what he said? He said, my Lord, my God. That doesn't make any sense. That doesn't make absolutely any sense. And the fact that he accepted this, the fact that Jesus Christ accepted Thomas calling him God is because he's God. To call him anything else is blasphemous. There's no open door for you to think of Jesus Christ as anything but God. And any other title that you may give him, you must also acknowledge he's God. You might say, well, Jesus Christ was a prophet. Truly, he did the function of a prophet while he was here, but he was God. To prophesy is to speak on behalf of God, and he came here as a messenger of God, the Bible says, but he still was God. And you say, well, he's a king. That is true. He is king, but he's God. But you have to understand he is God. And then Jesus said to him, Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet have believed. And that's where you and I come in. How many of you have actually seen Jesus Christ? I'm not raising my hand, you know, I just wanted to see if you raise your hand, but I'm not raising my hand. No, I have never seen Jesus Christ. I have never seen Jesus Christ. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6, and let's see what the Holy Spirit tells us about seeing 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 to 9. These are the words that the Holy Spirit gave us through the Apostle Peter. He says this, "In this you greatly rejoice, though for now, for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to the praise, honor, and glory of the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love. And though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Having not seen him, you love him." Amen? I pray to God that we love him. I pray to God. But you know what the expression of love truly is when it comes to God? Anybody knows? He said, "If you love me, you obey my commands." It is impossible to truly have a relationship with God and say, "But I'm going to be disobedient." It's not possible to have a good relationship with our Father God and be disobedient to him. Now, I'm not saying with that we're always obedient. Nobody is. We all falter. We all fall short. We all sin. But the Holy Spirit is always speaking to our hearts saying, "Okay, this is the perfect time to repent." It happens to me all day long. "Okay, John Paul, repent. I'm so sorry, Lord. I should have not said that." All day long. But in my heart, I have a desire to be obedient, although I fall short. Here he said, blessed or happy is also the word here for those who have not yet seen him, but they do believe. In Zechariah chapter 13, verse 6, it says, "And one will say to him, what are these wounds between your arms? And he will answer, these are the wounds that were given to me in the house of my friends." That's why when Jesus Christ rises from the dead, he continues to wear the wounds. It's prophetical that when he will show up to Israel, they will recognize him by the wounds that they gave him. You might say, "Well, the Jews didn't do it." Well, the Jews gave him to the Romans, and the Romans did it for them. But those wounds were received in the house of his friends in Jerusalem. So when he rises from the dead, the Jewish people will see, not when he rises from the dead, he already has risen from the dead, and of course, in the first years of the church were Jews, but what I'm implying is when he comes back again to the earth, he will come and he will wear, of course, his wonderful robe as a king, but he will be wearing his martyr's wounds. The testimony of him suffering for the sins of the world. And the Bible says that the Jewish people will turn to see and they will acknowledge that they actually had missed their Messiah. And they're going to, in their hearts, they're going to long and suffering as one who has lost a child. Now, I've never lost a child. I pray that I never go through that pain. But many of you are moms. I know one that I can see. I already saw her here. And she lost a child. And nobody knows what that pain is unless a person has gone through that pain. Well, think about a whole nation when they see Jesus Christ and they feel the same pain as if they lost their first child, because they're going to recognize all of these years were wasted as we rejected you. As we come to a close, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, it says, but I want to take you there because it's very important. The same message that we heard, and I mentioned it twice. I know I already shared the gospel with you twice, so I pray that the gospel render its effect of salvation upon your hearts for those of you who are not born again. But here's what it says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2. In verse 2, it says this, "For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it." You see that? The word is preached, and they hear it, but they will not embrace it by faith, and therefore they will reject it. The Hebrew people have rejected Jesus Christ, and they will continue because they have heard the same gospel, but their hearts are hard and callous. They have been blinded by the enemy, and they will not stop rejecting him until he comes. That's why when we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, we have to pray for the peace, but we also have to pray, Lord, open their eyes, and may they come before it's too late. Verse 30 on, it says this, and truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. That is the purpose of this gospel of John. That's the purpose, that by believing you may come to have eternal life. Now, I know for a fact I have eternal life. I never worried about my salvation. That's, you know, if you can worry about a lot of things, salvation should not be one. Because you should know. If you're born again, you should know it. And your own testimony states that you're born again, which is their testimony, the life that you live. And the love that you have for the Lord, the love that you have for his people, the love you have for his word, those are testimonies that guarantee that you are born again. If you don't have that, then you should start worrying. But if you have it, you have to stop worrying about that. But I'm actually talking to you. I don't know who you are, but if you at this time say, you know what, I am not sure if I was to die, I would go to heaven. Raise your hand. It's nothing to be embarrassed about, but you raise your hand and say, I'm not sure. I want to pray that you receive assurance. God bless you, man. I appreciate that for raising your hand. Anybody else? I see your hand, and I see your hand right there. Amen. Here is the guaranteed. Here is the guaranteed. And according to the scriptures, I'll read it to you. Let's go to, we're going to close with this. We're going to go to 1 John chapter 5, verse 9. I want this to be the guarantee as we're going to close. We're going to read all the way to verse 13. It says, if we receive the witness of men, meaning the testimony of man, if you trust when people tell you things, this is what he's speaking about. Then you have to trust what God is saying because the witness of God is greater. This is the witness of God which he testifies of his Son. He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself. He who does not believe God has made him a liar because he has not believed the testimony that God has given of his Son. And this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. This is the certainty that we have in Christ Jesus. Are you born again? You're a child of God. You're a child of God. You belong to the Father. You belong to the Father. You will be eternally in his presence when you depart from this body. If you don't have that assurance because you're not born again, I'm going to pray with you. And it's not the prayer that will bring salvation, but the Bible says if you believe that God rose Jesus from the dead, then you must confess him as Lord, and you shall be saved. Lord, Father, I'm praying with those who raised their hand and anybody else who can hear this, Lord, that if they've not yet called upon Christ as Lord and Savior, but they have believed in their heart that you rose him from the dead after he died for our sins, may they say, Jesus Christ, I believe you have risen to give me everlasting life after you died for my sins. You truly are God. You are my Lord and Savior. I pray now that you will empower me with the Holy Spirit to live a life that is pleasing to you. And may my life serve as an instrument for your glory. I love you and I thank you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. If that is you and you prayed that, please stop by our New Believers Room. It'll make us very happy to get to know who you are, give you some information, and give you a Bible if you don't have one. For the rest of us, I want to pray for you. Would you please stand up? We're going to pray for us as we close the service. We're going to worship together. He's going to actually sing the long version of the song, not the little tiny one, but the long one. And you're not going to leave until it's done. And then you're going to stop by the food court and eat if you want to. That's fine if not. But we're going to be here to pray for you if you need prayer. So let's pray. Lord, Father, I thank you so very much just for allowing me to be part of this beautiful congregation. I know, Father, I'm not worthy to stand here and to speak your word. But, Father, you have called those who are the least to confound the wise, Lord God. I have nothing to offer you, but I want to be obedient. So I pray that the word will go forth, empowered by the Spirit, and that which is yours will remain in our hearts. That which was mine will be forgotten. You will forgive me, Lord God, because you truly are a good God. And you will continue to help us to grow You'll manifest yourself to us as we seek to live to glorify you. You'll empower us to live every day in such a way that people will see Jesus Christ in our lives. And we cannot await, Lord God, until the coming of Christ. But until then, help us, Lord God, to live for you. We love you. We thank you and praise you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you all. Thank you.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King.
Bless you guys.